Praise the Lord. Turn with me to the book of Ephesians, chapter 5. Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians chapter 5, I'm going to read from verse 22. Ephesians 5:22. Husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself for her, that he might sanctify and cleanse her with the washing of water by the word, that he might present her to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she should be holy and without blemish. So husbands ought to love their own wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. For no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it, just as the Lord does to the church. For we are members of his body, of his flesh, and of his bones. Verse 31. For this reason a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This is a great mystery, but I speak concerning Christ and the church. Nevertheless, let each one of you in particular so love his own wife, so love his own wife as himself. Let the wife see that she respects her husband. Let's pray. Precious Father, we thank you for your word that is eternal. Your word is a roadmap. Your word leads, directs, and charts our course. Father, we can't function successfully without your word. Lord, we thank you because your word is coming out this morning. It's coming to our hearts. And we pray, Lord, that the Holy Spirit will open our eyes, our spiritual eyes, our hearts, and our minds to be able to receive that which you have planned for us this morning. Bless each of us, and may this word of God bring life. We thank you and give you praise. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. This morning I want us to look at marriage and why some marriages are healthy and others are stale with passing time. You wonder why people who fall in love, genuinely, sincerely fall in love, will renege on their promise. The passage we just read, as a matter of fact, summarizes to me what marriage should be. We have to understand this. And of course, I don't even need to say a whole lot on it, because anyone that is married understands that every marriage experiences some bumps on the way, or along the way. Doesn't matter how old your marriage has been, it doesn't matter how long you've been married, that as long as you have a taste of marriage, somehow, somewhere, marriage experiences bumps. Am I making sense? So we're going to look at some qualities that are present in successful and thriving marriages, even in good times and in bad times. Amen. You know, I was listening to Tom repeating his marriage vow on Wednesday at the registry. When the registrar was telling Tom to repeat after her, "Will you take this woman to be your lovely wedded wife, to love and to hold, to cherish and all that, in sickness and in health, for richer, for poorer?" Tom said, "For richer, for richer." That's what he said, right? I recall. For better, for worse, and he said, for better, for better. In sickness and in health, in health, something like that. He was very positive. I liked that. I liked it because Tom was prophesying, and Tom was actually using the word of God rather than what anyone would say. In other words, what Tom was saying, he said, this marriage is going to be better and what?
Better.
It's going to be richer and richer. There's nothing like in sickness. It's going to be health all the time. Praise the Lord. That was good. But why it was a positive reaction or positive way to look at marriage? It's also equally important for us to understand that marriage is not always going to be bed of roses. It's not always going to be for richer, for richer. As much as we want it to be for richer, for richer, for better, in health and in health, it's not always going to be that. Now, I'm not wishing anything negative. You understand what I'm saying? Have you been sick since you got married? Really sick?
Yes.
Have you lacked? Sometimes you lack since you got married? Has it always been the same since you got married?
No.
So, yeah, I don't want you to be naive to ever think that it's always going to be a bed of roses, because it's not going to be. Amen. But what is important is for us to follow the word of God, because the word of God is going to help us navigate through difficult times in marriage.
Amen.
So I want you to pay attention.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Or something that happened 2 weeks ago. I was coming to church. I think it was Bible study. So I saw these two vehicles. And these two vehicles on 149, right? 495. Pastor Chris, get your math correct. It's 495. Praise the Lord. So 495. And I saw these two vehicles, small cars, you know, sedan. They were just racing. I'm coming from different directions, actually. So they wanted to get into the center lane because it was open. And as both of them were approaching, suddenly they realized that they were merging at the same time. So what they did was to pull back, and the center was open. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
And that was a lesson for me. If they had not pulled back, guess what would have happened? They would have collided or crashed. And there would have been an obvious fatality and colossal damage in the process. But they were able to avoid that because they pulled apart, they pulled aside. So, while working on this sermon, I thought that would be a good way for us to look at marriage. When two people come together in marriage, no matter how they love themselves, there is no question that issues will arise, no question whatsoever in my mind. You will have individual tendencies, individual differences, idiosyncrasies, things that you will discover about each other that will begin to show up. In fact, preferences even, they will begin to show up. I do not believe in a minute that any normal couple or people, individuals who are normal, will enter into marriage relationship with the intention of divorcing eventually. I don't believe that. Well, some people today, you know, for certain reasons will go into it as a contract, which again, I don't encourage. Because I believe that when you are married, you are what? Married. So, but for the most part, people marry to stay because they love themselves. Amen?
Amen.
People don't marry to divorce, they don't marry to bail out. And yet we see a lot of divorce taking place today. Why? Because for the most part, nobody wants to go back. Even when there is an evidence of eventual collision, people still move ahead rather than pulling back in order to avoid problems. People prefer to give up rather than giving in. Pride is a dangerous thing. I want you to note that. One of the problems of marriage crisis is pride. I'm sorry. How long did that take me to say I'm sorry?
2 seconds.
I don't know whether it's up to 3 seconds. I'm sorry. 2 words. I'm sorry. Do you know that the word I'm sorry or statement I'm sorry will go a long way in solving problems? Now I'm talking to you, but I'm also talking to everyone here. Praise the Lord. It will take few seconds to resolve any problems whatsoever. And I mean resolve any problem whatsoever in few seconds. Whatsoever, when somebody has the humility to say, I'm sorry. Problems are resolved, no matter how big they are. And I can back that up from the scriptures. Proverbs chapter 15, 1 and 2. Proverbs 15, verses 1. Two. Proverbs 15, 1 and 2. Are we there? Here's what it says. Proverbs 15. It says, a soft answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger. Let me repeat that. A soft answer turns away wrath. You know what wrath is? Wrath is, it is strong, negative feeling concerning somebody on a thing. A soft answer turns away wrath. But a harsh word stirs up what? The tongue of the wise uses knowledge rightly, but the mouth of fools pour forth foolishness. This is critical. Doesn't matter how terrible the situation is, purely, the moment you say, what do you call your husband? What do you call him? Tom? Babe. You too? Babe? You call him babe? Is that what you call him? You don't know. Baby, it's the same as babe. What is the difference? You're looking at me as if. Praise the Lord. If you say, baby, I'm sorry. It doesn't matter what it is. Please note this. That God created us and gave us a soft heart. Are you listening to me? Purity. Whenever Tom is angry, say, baby, I'm sorry. Can you say that? Baby, I'm sorry. Tom, anytime there is anger, you see your wife getting angry, can you say, baby, I'm sorry? Can you repeat that? Good. See how fast you use it. Let me tell you. Didn't even take a second. But it has to come from your heart.
Amen.
Baby, I'm sorry. Do you know that baby, I'm sorry will solve the problem of 1 hour?
Amen.
A problem of 1 day?
Amen.
A problem of 1 week?
Amen.
Some people refuse just to humble themselves in a second or less than 5 seconds to solve a problem that will linger for days and weeks and months and some even years. That will be so expensive and costly to a point of ending up in the court. Think about this, and what I'm telling you is something that is real. When you say, baby, honey, darling, I'm sorry, it comes from your heart. Doesn't matter how tough the person is, that heart will soften, and that problem is solved. Church, please, can you learn? Can we learn couples to say, I'm sorry.
I'm sorry.
Don't say that to me. You didn't offend me. Go and say it to your wife and to your husband. Praise the Lord. I'm telling you, it solves a lot of problems. And it costs you nothing. It costs you nothing. Praise the Lord. It's just seconds. I'm sorry. Well, Pastor, what if I'm the only one that is saying sorry, sorry, sorry every time? I'm the one saying sorry, sorry every time. Even when he's wrong or when she's wrong, I keep saying sorry. So, what did we say? The one that apologizes is a wiser one. Note that the person that apologizes is a smarter one. When I say sorry to you, it means I am more intelligent than you. I am smarter than you. I know better than you. In fact, I'm just telling you without telling you that you are a dunce. That's what I'm saying. Without telling it to you. So don't feel bad if you're the one that is always saying sorry, sorry every time. But let me just tell you this. When you have the attitude of saying sorry, the other person will learn to say sorry once. And what I'm talking about is not a male thing or a female thing. It is not a gender thing. It is not the responsibility of the man or of the woman to say sorry. It's a collective what? Responsibility to say sorry. Listen, I'm not saying that arguments will not arise. Far from what I'm saying. Look, we're human beings, we have to be realistic. And if you're a couple here, you understand what I'm saying. You have arguments. Arguments is simply, let's put it this way, when I don't agree with your opinion, I have to say I don't agree. And sometimes because of the way I say it or because of your opinion, we may begin to argue. That's okay. It's okay to argue. Because we are human beings. We're expressing our intelligence. But argument is different from fighting. So when you argue on a thing, don't allow it to lead into a fight. Our quarrel. Praise the Lord. Learn to be peaceful. The first one I said is what? Pride. Pride goeth before a fall. Second is learn to be peaceful. Bible says in Hebrews chapter 12 verse 14, pursue peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall see them. Pursue peace, peace, peace. Pursue it. Go after it.
Amen.
Pursue peace with all men. Does that include your wife?
Mm-hmm.
Does that include your husband?
Yes.
It does. Hebrews 12:14. Number three, know your spouse.
Amen.
Growth is a process. So is marriage. It's a school. It's a learning curve where both of you have to study each other constantly. In fact, this is a school that you never graduate from.
Yes.
The only college you never graduate from, no matter how intelligent you are, because you keep discovering new things about each other. And it's a good thing, really. It's a holy thing to discover new things about each other. Praise the Lord. You never graduate from it. Know your spouse, know your wife. Know, study each other. You don't know each other yet. You need to take time to study each other. Don't ever think you know your spouse. No. Keep learning. Keep learning. When I first met my wife, I never knew her. Never knew her. I was an uncle. Never caught it. She came over. Came over in November. We had our wedding in December. Sometime around November, it was cold, so she came. She was shivering. It wasn't that cold. But because she was coming from a tropical weather, she was cold. So we understand. I said, well, let's go to the night market. So that'll be cheaper there, Mongkok market, for me to go and get her a sweater. So we went, you know. And she was majestically and elegantly walking. We got there and I saw this beautiful sweater. I said to her, try it. She said, no, it won't fit me. I said, no, it will fit you. Try it on. I don't even know if she remembers that story. I said, try it. She said, no. I'm saying to myself, oh, come on, what is this? This sweater will fit you. Try it. She said, it won't fit me. I won't try it on. Ever. I said, wow, is this what I'm getting myself into? Why don't you just try this thing on? And I'm telling you, that conversation didn't go well. Because one of us walked away. I can't remember if I was the one that walked away or if she was the one that walked away. Okay, see. So I walked away. Praise the Lord. And I was very angry. I was upset. Now her reason is, it won't fit me, number one. And secondly, I don't want to try this in the open because they didn't have a changing room. So I didn't think of any of this. Now let me tell you this, it's a school. Okay? It's a school. You got to learn. You got to know each other. You got to study each other. The things I did, we're 25 years in marriage. The things I did, there were a couple of things I did when we first got married. When I look back, I just bite my feet. Some of the things I did 5 years ago, I will never do them again.
Amen.
Some of the things I said last year, I will never say them again.
Amen.
Because we're growing by the day.
Yes, sir.
Now here's the thing. It's easier for me to be pinned on what I did when I was an infant. The things I did when I was small, when I was growing, you pin me on it. And you judge me based on it. You refuse to understand that life is a process, that marriage is growth. It grows. You fail to understand that you are actually growing. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Know your couple. I mean, know your spouse. Know each other. I've known my wife. Do I still know everything about her? No. Because I'm not God. But I know her. I know that she is a conservative introvert.
Wow.
Yes. Did you see my word, the adjective?
I like it.
Conservative introvert. You call her, Pastor Mika, how are you? She said, hello, how are you? And she will draw it. I'm okay. And she will be smiling on the phone. You are not seeing the person, you are smiling on the phone. That's okay. And she will draw it. And, you know, that's who she is. Me? Hello, how are you? God bless you. Boom. We're done. Move on. We just move on. Now, does it mean that I don't care? I care. But it's not me to. I'm also patient. But you see, I see that I have patience. And sometimes it's little bits over the top for me. But that's my wife. I have to learn who she is. If I've studied Tom and purity for a while. Tom, a purity, and me, we have similarity. We're vocal, we're outgoing, we're extroverts, you may not know that I am that extrovert. It's just because, you know, sometimes you have to, you know, as you grow, you have to be gentle. You remember, I'm a pastor, you know, you just have to, you know. But then, if you let me loose, you know that. You understand what I'm saying? So study each other, know each other. That's how we're going to function. The problem I had was that I wanted my wife to be me. I wanted her to do what I do. I wanted her, come on. You know, react. And she would just gently, you know, quiet. Not to a lot of humor. Not a lot of, you know, not very outgoing. She's outgoing, but not like me. But I'm humorous. I can crack jokes. Not a lot of jokes. And sometimes when I crack jokes, she feels like, are you born again, really? You Christian? It's jokes now. Come on. It's jokes. Be happy. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
But I know that is who she is.
Yes.
So what I do is I try to say, don't change me. And I won't change you. Be who you are so that I can be who I am. And if I'm who I am and you are who you are, that's why God brought us together. Because if I am fire and you are brimstone, it's going to be fire and brimstone. If you know what I'm saying, praise the Lord. Study each other. Know each other. Amen. Marriage is a school. Love each other. Learn to discuss rather than argue. That may be number three. Learn to discuss rather than argue. I said this earlier, even when you argue, don't fight. You see, most times couples wait until it gets to a boiling point before they address the issue. Have you noticed? Address it when it's fresh. Don't wait. And sometimes we wait. We wait and wait and wait, and suddenly you say, you know what? I've been watching you, I've been observing you. Stop watching, it's not television. Stop watching. Stop watching her. Address it. Address the issue as early as possible. Because if you keep waiting, it may get to a boiling point, a point where it becomes argument. Give each other some slack. It is dangerous to be a perfectionist. And I'm looking at the two of you. I can see one perfectionist or one who is close to being perfectionist here. You see, like me, When I come home, I want things to be where they were kept. That's you, right?
Yes.
I want things to be where they were kept. I don't want to come and I see things lying here and there. And so what I do is I start picking, I start putting them to. Sometimes I don't even know what I do. I start putting things. Give yourself some slack. Okay? Don't be a perfectionist. Because you're not. None of you is an angel. Praise the Lord. Yeah? Don't be too meticulous. And don't be too serious about life. If it is not a life-threatening situation, don't sweat it. It's not worth it. Are you following what I'm saying? It's not worth it. I like my room to sparkle, and everybody does. But when you have limited closet, and you have all these clothes, you know, clothes here and there, and sometimes some of them will end up in your bedroom. Where you don't want. Don't sweat it. This doesn't work elevating your blood pressure. Oh, why is this hanging here? Why is that? It's your bedroom. Nobody's coming to my bed. It's my bedroom. Are you following what I'm saying? Don't sweat it. It's not life threatening. Give room for error. Give room for error. 1 Peter chapter 3. 1 Peter chapter 3. We're going to read from verse 3. 1 Peter 3. Wives, likewise, be submissive to your own husbands, that even if some do not obey the word, they without a word may be won by the conduct of their wives, when they observe your chaste conduct accompanied by fear. Do not let your adornment be merely outwards, arranging the hair, wearing gold, or putting on fine apparel. Rather, let it be the hidden person of the heart, with the incorruptible beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit, which is very precious in the sight of God. For in this manner, in former times, the women who trusted in God also adorned themselves, being submissive to their own husband, as Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord, whose daughters you are if you do good and are not afraid with any terror. Listen. Sometimes we take a whole lot of time preparing for wedding and spend little time preparing for marriage. And we did tell you this during our council. A lot of time we don't pay attention. You know, Peter was saying, hey, dress nice, look nice, but that's not your priority. Your priority is your spiritual life. You got to be a child of God. Because when all these things we look at, then all these facade. You see this chandelier light shining when it turns off or when it's turned off. The real life will begin. And I can tell you that real life is in God. It's knowing the word of God. Yesterday, during the Word Keeper seminar, we talked about studying the Word of God. That's what Pastor Pre dwelt in on, the Word of God. It is the Word of God that will keep you.
Amen.
In trying times, because trying times will come. Amen. It is the Word of God that will sustain you. It is the Word of God that will build you. It's the Word of God. It's not the color of your hair. In fact, at that point, there comes a time you will be pulling your hair. You don't even give a bang. All these earrings, they don't matter at all. What matters is what is inside.
Amen.
The Word of God. You want to keep the Word of God. That's why the Bible says, let the Word of God dwell in you, richly in all wisdom. Let the Word of God dwell in you, richly. How does the Word of God dwell in you, richly? Number one, you study it.
Amen.
Number one, you come to church. You come to Bible study. Because here is what happens. You are good. Very soon now, you become a father. Mm-hmm. Amen. Yeah. You become a mother. That's why you got married. One of the reasons you got married is procreation. You didn't get married because you need somebody to cook for you. There are a lot of restaurants out there. In fact, you know how to cook. So it's not because you want to cook. No. Very soon you will start having kids. And the foundation you lay for your children is very critical.
Amen.
The seed that you study the Bible, they will study the Bible. You see them. Your children will be born in the church. They are children. See what I'm saying? That's a good life. God forbid, we don't want children that when the telephone rings and they say, oh, who knows where she is or who knows where he is and who knows the trouble she's going to do. That's not your portion in Jesus' name.
Amen.
But you see, it starts by you reading, studying, living for God. The inner beauty of submitting yourself to God, and then you will be able to submit yourself to your husband. Because the problem we have today is that we turn things upside down. Women love your husband. How can a woman love her husband if she doesn't love the Lord?
Amen.
Especially in the world that we live today where it says 50-50. Thank God you brought it up yesterday. It's not 50-50.
Yeah.
Because if it's 50-50, there's going to be a lot of disappointment. It's not, life is not 50-50. Husband and wife 50. Husband 50 wife. No. It's actually 0 over 100. Zero over 100. So the time we live in requires the word of God to be formed in us richly. Because the time will come when the reality of life will set in. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
So we have to submit to the word of God. Amen. He said, people will sit down and they will give glory to God. Verse 3, don't be defined by outward appearance. Be defined by inward beauty. Your hair is not, it's okay. But that's not your beauty. Your beauty is inside. Because I'm telling you, I see a lot of ladies that have wonderful hair. Good room, good makeup. You look at them, God does, and the moment they open their mouth to talk to you, Jesus help me. Are you feeling what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
So that's not where beauty lies. Beauty is inside. And I will say to myself, thank you, Jesus.
Yeah.
My son will never marry somebody like this.
Amen.
God forbid. Oh, you see a gentleman well dressed, and please, let's even not go there. They will cuss you out, and you'll be wondering, did you even come from a home? Any value at all? Praise the Lord. Bible says there were holy women of old who trusted the Lord in verse 5. They made themselves nice in this way by obeying their husbands. Sarah obeyed her husband and called him Lord or Master. And he says, you are children of Sarah if you do the same thing. Lord and Master doesn't mean Tom comes back and crosses his leg and sits on the sofa with television, I mean, a newspaper, iPad, and remote control of one, and you're running around, and she turns around to say, well, I need this, I need that, and you're giving it to him, and he sits there to say, well, don't you understand that I'm your Lord and your Master? That's not what it means. No, you can't do that. You won't even walk. You won't even walk, even if you try. Praise the Lord. Yeah. It means honor each other, respect each other. You got to respect each other. Falling in love is not a choice, but being in love is.
Amen.
Yes.
You have to be in love. And it requires renewal of your affection day after day after day. One other thing is you have to avoid blame game. You have to avoid blame game. Blame game is dangerous. It's dangerous. Oh my God, I didn't know that's how she is, Pastor. I didn't know how That's how bad she is. Really? You don't know how, that is how bad your wife is. That shows how intelligent you are. No, if you don't know how bad your wife is before you married her, or how bad your husband is, that means you are not intelligent. As a matter of fact, she is not bad. You understand what I'm saying? Because I don't believe that. No. The thing is, you don't understand how good your husband or your wife is. Not how bad she is. Because there is something good about everyone. But we only concentrate on the negative things. The positive things we ignore. The Bible says anything that is good, anything that is of repute, anything that is pure, dwell on these things. Praise the Lord. Tongue and purity. And everyone here, don't look at the negative sides of each other because there are many.
Yes,
you are going to find the down, drawn, negative side of each other. If you dwell on it, you are heading straight to crisis. There are good things about each other. That's why you got married. There is something you saw on her. Character trait that you saw her, good quality character that you saw her that attracted you to her. Is that correct? Dwell on that. And the same with your purity. Dwell on that. I don't like it when people, somebody will say, we'll just point out, look at what you did. In all the good things somebody is doing, you don't see it. It's just this one that somebody did wrong. How about that's not right. Are you following what I'm saying? There is something good about somebody. Something good about your spouse. Dig it out, and you'll be amazed the kind of a person she is. I said you should honor one another, respect one another, appreciate one another. Don't only comment when they do something bad. That's really bad. And I mean it. It's bad. Find something good. Marriage is a lifelong partnership and unbreakable union, a covenant between two people. And an intimate community of life and love. None of you is perfect.
Amen.
And because none of you is perfect, don't expect too much from each other. Amen?
Amen.
Forgive one another. I'm rounding up. Forgive one another. Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4, 31 and 32. Ephesians 4, 31 and 32. It says, therefore, I'm sorry, 31, 32. Let's start from verse 30, because it will help us to understand. It says, and do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. Verse 32. And be kind to one another. Can we read that together? Verse 32. What to go?
To one another.
Tender heart.
Forgive.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Put off all bitterness. Be kind to one another. Tender-hearted. Let me say this. Look, when you see couples that have strong, good relationship, it's not because they don't see anything wrong on each other.
Amen.
No, that's not. It's just because, number one, we have to be kind to one another. Okay? The first place we read in Ephesians, it says that the husband and the wife They're one. One body. Nobody hates his body. If I hate my wife, I hate myself. If I love my wife, I love myself. I'm not doing her any favor by loving her. I love my wife. I love my wife. I don't need to say it because I love my wife. Praise the Lord. Love is not only I love you. I love you. Can you imagine? You love somebody by action, by being gentle and tender-hearted and caring. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
And serving.
Amen.
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 So the Bible says, be tender-hearted. Loving one another. Caring for one another. And forgiving one another. Even as God in Christ forgave you. Forgive one another. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Forgive one another. Can we say that together?
Forgive one another.
Give one another. Because lack of forgiveness is the root of bitterness.
Yes, sir.
And when we don't forgive, it piles up. But if we forgive, well, Pastor, this one is unforgivable. Mm-hmm. No, there is nothing that Jesus didn't forgive us.
Amen.
As bad as we were, he forgave us.
Amen.
Amen? So, the act of forgiveness is deliberate.
Yes, sir.
You have to be deliberate in forgiving one another. You have to be intentional about forgiving one another. A psychiatrist noted, quote, those with whom you choose to remain angry with control you. They will limit your physical, emotional, and spirit, limit you emotionally, physically, and spiritually. Forgiveness emancipates the heart and fills married life with peace. If you don't forgive somebody, that person is controlling you. Husband or wife. So happily married couples have discovered the healing grace that is present in the grace and art of forgiveness and reconciliation. Sometimes, and it's been a while, that my wife and I will have that huge argument and that will last for a while. I can't remember. Now I'm not saying this because we're perfect, but I'm also saying this because we're pastors.
Amen.
If we don't love one another, how dare I come here to tell you to love one another? Are you following what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. So we should be your example. So I'm not bashful in telling you that.
Hallelujah!
I'm not bashful to tell you that we don't quarrel, we don't fight. Do we have, you know, some misunderstanding of when I'm driving and she's telling me to brake? Allow me to drive. I'm the driver. I taught you how to drive. What's the problem? And then when she's driving, it's zooming off. I say, look who is talking. You know, so sometimes you have those kind of arguments, right?
Yes, sir.
But the bottom line is this. If you fail to forgive somebody, you're hurting yourself.
Mm-hmm.
And there is joy. Now, what I was actually saying is, when eventually you go to your spouse and say, honey, baby, darling, I'm sorry. It will amaze you how everything will feel like it never happened before.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Let's try it again. Say, now you can say this. I'm sorry. Say it.
I'm sorry.
Praise God.
I'm sorry.
Learn to say it. Learn to apologize. It will bring a lot of healing. Excuse me. And for those of you who have been hurt in the past, and you are saying, so what am I supposed to do now? My husband left me, my wife left me. Don't worry about it. You are where you are. God meets you where you are.
Amen.
Amen. He sees you where you are. He loves you where you are. You have to learn to communicate. You have to learn to be flexible. Don't be rigid. You know that you are saved by grace.
Amen.
And the Lord will help us.
Amen.
Did you get something?
Yes.